Once again, I just want to reiterate what Debbie said in welcoming you all, and if this is your first time, we hope to get to meet you today and say hello formally. I think we're in store for a wonderful talk. I've had the pleasure of visiting with our speaker this morning, and prior to her visit coming, and she has such a wealth of knowledge, and we have so much to learn in this arena, so we're very, very blessed and grateful for her joining us today. And so without further ado, let me introduce to you our speaker for today. Dr. Karen Likens is the Director of Integrated Behavioral Health Partners, where she specializes in system transformation in health, behavioral health, human service fields through strategic planning, organizational development, evaluation, and quality improvement. Dr. Likens has led more than 70 research, evaluation, technical assistance, and strategic planning projects for federal agencies, states, foundations, health plans, and community-based organizations and clinics. Dr. Likens works to develop strong strategic partnerships across the safety net, which enables community partners to overcome barriers to care, coordination, and achieve better clinical and cost outcomes. So without further ado, Dr. Likens, welcome.
Great. Thank you. It's really a pleasure to be here today. I feel like I've walked into a room where I don't know anybody, which is always a little, and I like to know who I'm talking with. So I just want to take a little poll at the beginning here. How many of you are direct service providers? Okay. How many of you work in behavioral health? How many of you are primary care folks or more on the medical side? Okay, that's helpful. How many of you have worked in integrated settings?
Excellent.
Okay, so I'm actually speaking to experts. Because as Mary Beth was saying, I've been doing this work for a long time, but what I find is that healthcare is local, behavioral health is local, and every community has its own constellation of things that work and don't work. So what I'm going to try to do today is to share with you some best practices, to share with you,
I'm just realizing I don't have one.
Share with you, why we want to do integrated behavioral health, different models, best practices, and then I'm going to get a little bit into the issue of how do you know that you're making a difference. And I won't be spending a lot of time on that, even though it's actually my favorite topic because I wasn't asked to talk about that. But, I can't just come into a setting and not talk about how do you know that you're making a difference. So that slide just details what I'm going to be talking to you about. Now, in this country, and actually probably in most places around the world, we have a problem of fragmentation. And what we've done through in medicine and in our disciplines is we've actually separated the mind from the body, and we don't really do a very good job of connecting them. We also do the same thing with our systems. We have a clinical delivery system, medicine, behavioral health. We have different payment and financing streams that fund those different systems. And then there are different expectations from the community regarding what providers are going to do. And, for those of you in behavioral health, you know that there's a lot of stigma associated with behavioral health. And so that creates fragmentation as well. And then our training and education systems train people in their disciplines. It's not typical to get trained, to work in a team, trained to think, a physician doesn't often get trained in behavioral health, at least initially. And so fragmentation is the problem. And of course, what fragmentation leads to are ineffective strategies. And this slide is a little small for you to read, but the impact of fragmentation is that it actually produces bad outcomes. And this pie chart on the left is showing you outcomes. These are the causes of avoidable deaths in the United States. 40% of unavoidable deaths are because of behavioral issues, substance use, smoking, things like that. Genetics also contributes to that. And of course, the environment intersects with genetics. But you look at this in terms of healthcare, and that's a very small piece of the pie, 10%. So 10% of healthcare contributes to our health is affected by healthcare only by about 10%. Yet over here you see that we invest most of our money in health and medicine, and that's not producing the biggest bang. So part of what we want to do, part of what has been going on the last, through Obamacare and what's been happening at the federal level and also at the state levels, is a movement toward trying to rejigger the system so that we are investing more in prevention, we're investing more in integrated care, we're investing more in health homes and medical homes, that kind of thing, so that there's a more holistic way of approaching healthcare. So the idea here is that the solution would be integration. And this is kind of a funny slide, I don't think it really works, but the idea is to be able to wrap care around a patient. The patient really needs to be at the center, and this is person-centered care. But this is also integrated care, because you would have these different disciplines actually working together to support the needs of the patient. And what's missing here, you kind of see, I've got social work. What's missing here are all the community supports. It's all this work, that you do in the community as well. The intersection with the criminal justice system, with hospitals, with with churches, and schools. This is a very shallow podium, so that's why I'm putting my paper over there, because it's kind of falling around. So the idea, that's my scarf. Now I'm causing my own problems. You didn't know that you were going to be entertained by my scarf. So integrated behavioral health is a great strategy, as this is like the big bang that I've been waiting to get to. It's a great strategy for improving patient experience and also yielding better outcomes. And there's a lot of evidence that shows that integrated care reduces stigma. It increases access because of reduced stigma. It also, is a very effective strategy for reaching vulnerable populations that typically are not going to, have the means or the resources to be able to, get to behavioral health settings. And so through primary care, that's a great avenue to get people, into the behavioral health services. And in 2005, the Institute of Medicine actually put out a report that said that quality and equality in the healthcare system are completely linked to integrated behavioral health. So what is integrated behavioral health? The definition that I'm using today, I hope, there it is that, and you probably have seen many different definitions, and you may have your own definition, but what I think is important in integrated behavioral health is that it's that intentional, ongoing, and committed coordination and collaboration among all providers and the individual in treatment, bringing all of that together. And this is going to be a theme that you're going to hear from me, because we can't do integrated care without bringing the individual in. It's also providers recognizing and appreciating the interdependence that they have with each other and the patient and client to positively impact healthcare outcomes. And I emphasize the interdependence because, in our society, and this isn't necessarily a bad thing, it becomes a challenge. We tend to privilege the medical model. We tend to privilege medicine over other disciplines. And medicine is super important. But as you saw from that pie chart, if it's only contributing 10% to outcomes, but we're investing all of our resources there, we need to realign things. And so the idea here is to start thinking more very differently and recognizing that there is interdependence A primary care physician can do his or her job so much better if they have other resources so that they, you know, can actually attend to the physical health needs of the patient. But if the patient is coming in presenting signs of depression, they're not necessarily the best person to be dealing with that. And it works out so much better when they have somebody else that they can share the care with. Now, as part of this presentation, I'm supposed to be talking with you all about models. And when Mary Beth and Debbie had first reached out to me and said, you know, could you do this presentation today? We want to hear about best practice models and what works and all that. I realized that, you know, that's not so easy because there are many different models. But as I said at the beginning, all healthcare is local. And so you can't just take a model off the shelf and stick it in. You know, there's no perfect recipe. So the way that I'm going to talk about this today, and for those of you who know the Myers-Briggs, I'm an INFP, so I'm a kind of a big concept person. So I'm not going to be talking so much at that level of the STJ, you know, here's the more of a linear way to go about this or that sort of thing. I'm really going to be giving you kind of the big picture. So if you can just bear with me, we've got three basic structures for integrated care. The first one is up there, it's the referral. So in that model, you would have behavioral health and medical, so primary care, bi-directional referrals. So maybe somebody's presenting in a behavioral health clinic and they haven't seen a physician in years. And you know, we know that population of the seriously mentally ill tend to die 25 years earlier than the average population. So the idea here is that they would be able to be referred over to medicine. And then the converse. The problem with that model is that often communication breaks down. There is no communication. You kind of throw the, you know, here's your referral, oh, I hope you showed up. And that's not really what we want in integrated care. The second model is co-location. Well, it could be the third model too, but the second model, co-location, that is a gold standard for a lot of people. It's a really wonderful way to think about it. It's where you have primary care embedded with behavioral health or vice versa. The problem with co-location is if you have no connection, you know, where you don't have shared care plans, where you don't have shared electronic health records, that sort of thing, where you're, you know, you can be co-located and still not be integrated. Now over here with coordination and partnership, it's just a different version of these two, because it could be, you know, these could be organizations that could also be within a clinic. And the reason that I have the barbed wire around that is that a lot of times what you see in these models, There is intentional coordination, and you know, we're going to partner, and we've got our MOUs, and we're all happy. And then all of a sudden, you start hearing about HIPAA and 42 CFR, and oh my gosh, we can't possibly, you know, I can't share my notes with you. You know, I'm going to tell you a joke. Knock knock. Can't tell you. So this is another way to think about this. I just wanted to include this because really what we're talking about are providers. So in this first model, this is where you embed the mental health or substance use provider in primary care, and the services are in primary care. And I know that that's kind of the model that you all have here. It's a great model. Over here is really looking more on the for the seriously mentally ill population, typically they are going to a behavioral health clinic, and so it's bringing in the primary care into that environment or having some intentional coordination across organizations. And I showed you that just because I think it's important to have us remember that there are people that we're talking about. We're talking about patients, but we're also talking about providers. How many of you are familiar with the fourth quadrant model? Excellent. So the fourth quadrant model is actually, this is a good way to think. Remember, I'm an INFP. So it's big picture. If you think about 100% of your population in this community, at any given time, quadrant one, there are going to be people who have low behavioral health needs and low physical health needs. Quadrant two, high behavioral health needs, low physical health needs. Quadrant three, low behavioral health, high physical health. And quadrant four, high. Now, the reason that we want to think about that is when you're doing your planning, when you're thinking about capacity for behavioral health services and, you know, what you need to have in a primary care setting, for example, this is your population, usually. You know, low behavioral health, low physical health, people coming in routinely for their exams, that kind of thing. Quadrant three is also your population. You have people with high physical health needs, but they don't really have, you know, that many behavioral health needs. Up here, quadrant two and quadrant four, that's actually where we start seeing the need for true integration. Because in a primary care setting, you really do need to have behavioral health providers to be able to address the needs of that population. And the reality is that a lot of people actually in a typical FQHC or primary care clinic actually are up there. You know, people who have diabetes who also have depression, things like that. And that becomes part of the rationale and really an important way to understand your population and to think about your population to say, do we have the right mix of staff? Are there issues that we're not able to address? It doesn't mean that you need to necessarily be able to address everything in-house, but you need to be able to have the relationships in the community for referrals and that sort of thing. And, you know, I think it's, at this point, I just want to remind everybody that according to the National Comorbidity Study, there's an estimated 29% of adults with medical conditions like diabetes who also have behavioral health conditions. So that's a third of your population, almost, that has, you know, one chronic condition. And if they have one chronic condition, they're likely to have a behavioral health need. This is way too small to see, and in this it's even worse. But I wanted to include this, and I can actually make the citation available to you all. This is from the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, and this is showing the spectrum of integrated behavioral health care. And the idea here is that there's a developmental continuum of integrated models. So on the left-hand side, we have it's coordinated, and the key element there is communication. And what you have there is kind of level one and level two are minimal and then increasing collaboration, you know, across, that would really be across organizations. And then in this middle section, that's the co-location piece, where you have physical proximity. That's like a driving component of that. So there's communication, but there's also the physical proximity. And then on the far right, we have the different levels that are associated with true integration. And really, there are two key elements there. The first is that there really is a differentiator. The first is that their practice is truly transformed. The way that people deliver services is changed. So you have a scenario where you would have a primary care physician doing a warm handoff to a behavioral health clinician. That's something that is very different than what you would typically see, you know, in this, just where you have the co-location. The second piece, and this really is the differentiator across the board, is the increased communication, is the frequency of communication. So on this far right side, there is a far greater frequency of communication between the primary care and behavioral health providers. I forgot to mention, if any of you have questions, I don't mind being interrupted, too. So, I said before that I can't give you the recipe for, you know, perfect integration, and there is no perfect model. But what we know from the research, and what we know from, you know, the evidence base out there, and best practice models, is that there are some core functions that are very much associated with effectiveness. And in fact, there are 8 of them. And that's what these are. Organizational mission and culture, population health management, a team approach, patient and family education and engagement, staff competencies that are beyond usual care, universal screening for the most prevalent behavioral health conditions, integrated treatment planning, and the systematic use of evidence-based practices. And I'm going to go through each of these. So just, you know, just keep in mind, these are kind of the, across all of the studies, you know, the different models and that sort of thing, these have been identified as really the key functions, the key elements that ideally would be present in whatever you're implementing. So the first one, and I was saying Mary Beth earlier, in a lot of ways, I think that this is one of the most important. I don't think that you can have integration if you don't have an organizational mission and culture that supports integration. And it's really hard to measure, and people don't typically measure it. Well, actually, it's not that hard to measure. I mean, you can look for things like, you know, is it in your mission statement that you want to be holistic? Or, you know, do you actually incentivize providers to play nicely together and, you know, provide integrated care? Do you have shared care, care plan or accessible medical records, that kind of thing? So those are indicators of it, but we tend to forget it. And it's, you know, so the idea here is that it's part of the mission, that leadership actively supports it and promotes it across the organizational function. So there's that expectation. And then there's also, in some of the best programs that I've seen, and this gets to my comment earlier about the primacy of the medical model, in the organizational structure of clinics where that are truly integrated and where the commitment to integration is sustained, there's equal leadership. So you have a medical director, but you have a behavioral health director that sits on the leadership team and is part of decision making. Helping to make decisions about what fields are going to go into the health information system, you know, that sort of thing. And then there's also this concept of the parity between the medical and the behavioral health providers on a team, that interdependence, that recognition that everybody has a role, everybody is contributing to the health and good outcomes of patients. The next component is population health management. And this is something that increasingly, I'm sure you've been hearing about it because it's been very much part of the ACA and the broader work nationally, recognizing that we need to think beyond one patient, one patient, one patient, and get more into the mode of thinking in terms of population. And in this case, typically what you're talking about are, you know, it's recognizing, and I know that you have a grant, where you're targeting individuals with diabetes and depression. And so that's, you know, it's coming up with an intentional way of managing that population where you can demonstrate that, you know, through the integrated care, you're improving their outcomes. Typically with population health management, you use registries so you can keep track of people. And the registries will have flags in them reminding people about appointments, and you know, they have lots of different functions. But then the registries also allow you to be able to measure and look, you know, track outcomes over time. Team approach. Now this is truly the hallmark of a strong integrated model. It's where healthcare, where, you know, it's not a scenario where you have the primary care physician making a referral out to behavioral health. It's where you actually have the providers working intentionally as a team. And there's strong communication, collaboration, and coordination between those providers. And recognizing that that sometimes in order to achieve, you know, the health outcomes that you want for somebody with diabetes, their depression needs to be taken care of. Like that's really the issue of, you know, why they're not, the outcomes are not improving. Then there's the issue of staff competencies. And this is tricky because if you think back to one of my earlier slides where I had education up there and training, in our schools, in our, you know, schools, professional schools, we don't typically train people to work in teams. People learn this on the job. How many of you in school learned how to work on a team? Excellent. Are you gerontologists, geriatrics, or anything like that? Anybody? Because that's one discipline where, you know, a lot of times there's recognition that you work on in interdisciplinary teams, multidisciplinary teams. But this becomes a challenge. And so when you are hiring, when you are engaging new staff in these types of services, you really need to be aware that you have to be aware of the blinders that they may have or the resistance that they may have coming into an environment because they've been trained to do something differently. So for example, with behavioral health, a lot of times behavioral health providers have been brought up in a modality where they see somebody for 50 minute session. Well, in integrated care, a lot of times you need to have briefer sessions. You know, you might be seeing somebody for 15 minutes. It depends on, you know, how you set up your model. There's also that issue of, can somebody be interrupted? Because, you know, if you have two providers, two behavioral health providers, and a primary care physician has a client right there who could benefit from a warm handoff, can they interrupt the behavioral health provider who might be seeing somebody just to, you know, kind of say hello and say, okay, you know, I'm going to make an appointment with you. So this is where, you know, the idea of staff competencies and workforce competencies has to expand beyond what we would typically have in our expectations for any discipline. You know, you're looking at competencies that are related to really being able to work together and also being able to leverage across the team. There's that whole issue of being able to work to the top of your licensure, and ideally what you want is to be able to push down certain work to other providers so that, you know, the physician can be freed up to do the physical health medical care that's billable, and then other providers can be engaged to do work that's also billable, you know, within their discipline. So then there's universal screening for the most prevalent health and behavioral health conditions, and this is actually related to the triple aim. How many of you know the triple aim? Okay, that's where we want to reduce costs by improving patient and provider experience and also improving population health. It's related to what I was talking about earlier around the population health piece. But the idea here is that in order to do that, we need to screen, we need to know what these conditions are, and then they need to be able to be addressed. And the best way to do that is to regularly and universally screen for substance use disorders and different behavioral health conditions that present in primary care that really lead to very costly, if they are not addressed, they lead to costly outcomes like hospitalizations, emergency department utilization, that kind of thing. And then the idea here too is that the screening results are addressed in the treatment plan. So just because you've screened, I mean, I've seen lots of clinics where they screen for substance use. I'm sure that my scarf looks beautiful by now. Where they screen for substance use, but those results don't make it into the chart. They're like on the face sheet, but they're not there. So when the patient goes to see the primary care physician, how would they ever know that they're, you know, that they're drinking 20 glasses of wine a week or, you know, whatever? So it's a, you know, that's part of the secret sauce with the integration. And then there's integrated treatment planning. I've been alluding to this as I've been talking. It's this idea that every patient has a single integrated plan. And ideally, the patient has been part of making that plan, setting goals, and, you know, participating in it. And that's a little weird on the medical side. It's not often that you involve, it's not common practice to involve patients in, you know, it's specialty diagnosis that you're doing. But the idea here is that you really have to think about the individual, the patient, in a much more holistic way and be very clear about their context. So if you have a homeless patient who comes in for services and you're making a prescription of this, you make a prescription that has to be refrigerated, they may not be able to do anything with that. You know? They may not have a refrigerator. So it's really understanding that broader context. And I'm going to take this off. I need like the commercial break. Okay,
there,
that's much better. I lose all my color, but. So is all of this making sense?
Yeah.
And then finally, this is actually, are you familiar with the Meadows Mental Health Policy Institute here in Texas? So Meadows has actually identified this as an increasingly important component, this concept of systematic use of evidence-based bias. And what I think is interesting is the way that they've framed it. They talk about it at two levels. The first is evidence-based practices. So that would be things like the impact model and the collaborative care model, which I'm going to talk about in a minute. But then they also talk about it at another level, which are practices or techniques that are used in the models. So that would be things like motivational interviewing, cognitive behavioral therapy. Those are all, you know, practices, models, strategies that have evidence. They have an evidence base, they're supported in the literature, and by using evidence-based practices, you can be more guaranteed that you're going to have better patient outcomes, assuming that you have fidelity and that, you know, people are actually doing the practices the way that they are supposed to. So just to review, before I move into a little bit more detail on things, the key features of successful models, and, you know, I just gave you those core components, which are really important, but this is another way to kind of think about it, is communication, and it's having the warm handoffs versus referrals, because people, you know, honestly, people do better when they have a more clear connection and get engaged in services. The second is shifting in the scope, making a shift in the scope of practice and the approach to practice. And that would be something like using a consulting psychiatrist instead of expecting the psychiatrist to have a big caseload. Because you can extend their scope of practice that way. Coordination, and this is where, you know, having the primary care physician be the prescriber instead of having two prescribers, or having some, you know, intentional collaboration between, you know, a psychiatrist or something like that and the PCP, that's an important component. Engagement and activation. You know, when we think about recovery and when we think about the need for self-management skills, engagement and activation are really critical components of effective care. And that's both on the health side, and it's also on the behavioral health side. And when you bring the two together, it's pretty important. And then the final piece, you know, as I was mentioning before, is the data-driven care. If you're not measuring outcomes along the way, you never know if you're really making a difference. And I think that, you know, when I say this to an audience with more of a medical background, that seems like, you know, kind of a no-brainer. Because there's a lot of measurement that happens in medicine. You have tests, you have all these different things. You can see if people get better. In behavioral health, culturally, we haven't really done that much measurement. You know, it's kind of a new thing. And it's really important, as it turns out. And, you know, it's not that folks in behavioral health, you know, don't think that it's important. It's just, it has not been really part of our culture to track outcomes. And so that becomes you know, one of the hurdles for integration. So now I'm going to talk about the impact model. How many of you are familiar with this? Great, excellent. And this is just, I'm going to go into a little bit of detail on this because it helps illustrate what I'm talking about. This is a model that was developed by Jürgen Unitzer at the University of Washington, Group Health Cooperative, and it's associated very closely with the collaborative care model. And the thing about impact is that Jürgen's been developing it now for at least 20 years. I mean, it's been very well researched. It's been implemented in many settings. It started off as a targeting the elderly and depression, and now it's been tested with many other populations, and it's been shown to be very effective. And in fact, it has been shown to double the effectiveness of usual care when it's done to fidelity. So it's pretty important in terms of being able to lower healthcare costs because it's very predictable. And there are five key components to it. There's communication. Oops, look at me, I forgot. Oops, kind of blathering on. There are the five key components: collaborative care, you have a depression care manager, designated psychiatrist, there's outcome measurement, and then there's step care. So there's an expectation that people are going to get better. I mean, this is another kind of challenge in the context of the behavioral health. We have effective strategies, and people do get better, but there are disincentives within our system, especially for the seriously mentally ill, where people go into disability and they're not, the system has kind of the perverse incentives to keep people, there. And there's not an expectation of recovery and improvement. And so that's just it's a challenge that's out there. It's like a kind of a mental model that's out there that we can break down through integration. And I just, I want you all to kind of be aware of that and to hold on to that. So in terms of the first component, this is collaborative care. And the idea here is that you have three main players on an impact team. You have the primary care physician, you have the care manager, and then you have a consulting psychiatrist. And then you often will have other providers that articulate with the team, but these folks have the primary responsibility working together. They're kind of a triumvirate. And the idea here is that the primary care provider does the referrals and works with the care manager to develop the treatment plan and to implement the treatment plan and to do the prescriptions. And then there's also an assumption here that the patient or the client has an active role as well, because they would have a role in saying, yes, I want to take antidepressants, or no, I don't want to, but I want to try, doing the talk therapy, or so there's some agency in there. And then both the care manager and the primary care provider consult with the psychiatrist in this context, particularly if the treatment is not improving. So the second piece here is the depression care manager. And what I think is really important to note, and this gets back to that kind of overarching piece of, yes?
I'm sorry, I had a quick question. Going back to that slide prior to this one. So for that collaborative care, that key component number one, it's the primary care provider and a care manager. So is more the is the psychiatrist not really, are they just kind of consulting if there's no improvement? So they're not really giving direct care to that client.
They might be seeing the client, but not as a major player.
Right, like the PCP would be the one providing the site.
Exactly. The idea is to be able to leverage the psychiatrist's time to be consulting and to be supportive to both the primary care physician on the prescribing side of things, and then also with the care manager, just in terms of advice on behaviors and that sort of thing.
Okay.
So the in terms of workforce competencies, this first piece of with the depression care manager, what is really interesting about the impact model, and this goes back to my point about all healthcare is local, this has been tested in so many different places and so many different ways that you know, if you ask Jurgen, what's, who has to be the depression care manager, he would say, well, it depends. And, you know, they've tested it with nurses, psychologists, social workers, licensed counselors, you know, a variety of people. This is where, you know, it depends on the reimbursement environment, it depends on, you know, what the skill set is of the individual in terms of being able to do the care management for the population. The roles of the care manager: educates the patient about depression, supports antidepressant therapies prescribed by the patient's primary care provider. If it's appropriate, that would really be more the nurse, but it could also be a psychologist. Coaches patients in behavioral activation and pleasant events scheduling. Offers a brief 6 to 8 session course of counseling, such as problem solving therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, that sort of thing. Monitors depression symptoms for treatment response. So that's measurement. So using PHQ-9 at regular intervals to see, is somebody getting better? Completes a relapse prevention plan with each patient who has improved. So as improvement is happening, then you start talking about, you know, well, how are we going to prevent relapse? And that's very, that's a very intentional step in this model. And the typical caseload is pretty high, at 100 to 150 patients. But that's because, you know, it is a very targeted and intentional strategy where you have the primary care physician working with the care manager with the support from the psychiatrist. And there are some similar roles, like you can have the embedded behavioral health specialist, the embedded behavioral health consultant. I mean, these functions, it's a function that's being provided as opposed to, you know, a specific, you know, position. Does that make sense? And this is in a primary care setting. So the final three components, the designated psychiatrist consults to the care manager and the PCP on the care of patients who don't respond to treatments as expected. So this also, you know, gets into that whole art of, you know, being aware of what expectations are. You have your goal setting, but you also are measuring, so you can triangulate this information in. You can find out, you know, is what we're doing for your depression working? Well, why not? You know, maybe it's the medication isn't working, or maybe, you know, we need a different kind of conversation in our therapy sessions. The fourth piece here is the outcome measurement, as I have mentioned a couple of times. And what you do is you measure very at regular intervals throughout the course of treatment. And typically the PHQ-9 is used, but there are other measures that people use. You know, it's whatever works and whatever people are used to. I mean, what I typically say when people say, you know, what's the best tool, I say, what's the tool that you're going to use and you're actually going to use it in a routine manner? Because half the battle is actually doing the measurement. And then the final piece is the step care. And this is where you adjust treatment based on clinical outcomes and according to an evidence-based algorithm. And you're aiming for a 50% reduction in symptoms within 10 to 12 weeks. And if the patient doesn't improve within that period of time, then you change the course of treatment. Another way that people talk about this is treat to target. And again, on the medical side, this isn't so unusual. But in behavioral health, this concept is, you know, it's new. It's not as routine. So this kind of brings it all together, and this is you know, the impact team. The impact team identifies and tracks depressed patients. They're doing case finding in a, you know, in a clinic, and they do the screening and referral, and then confirm the diagnosis. There's proactive follow up and tracking, and then the next piece is really that focus on the self management, because again, if you think about that first slide, in this model, the patient is really part of the care team. And so there you have education and a brief therapy to activate the patient. And then The supports for additional treatment include primary care, that's the antidepressant medications, and then especially mental health care and psychotherapy. That's if, you know, if the person is not responding, if the patient's not responding to what you're doing, it may well be that they need more intensive services. That wouldn't necessarily happen in the context of primary care unless you have that capacity. This would be a scenario where you would do the referral out. And then finally, use mental health consultation for difficult cases. And this is where, again, where you would bring in the psychiatrist for consultation. There's also caseload supervision that happens here in consultation for the care managers. Because, you know, I mean, I'm kind of blithely saying, oh, this works so great. I mean, it does work. It works really well. But it requires a lot of attention. And you get really great outcomes, but, you know, this is an evidence-based practice. So I've given you a lot of information, and, you know, as you're trying to think about, like, how do you want to improve, extend, scale up your focus on integration and your integrated services, you know, I've given you a lot, and that's kind of the camera that you ideally have. It would be like the super camera that does everything, but, you know, who can carry that? I mean, this is really what we use all the time for our, I mean, who doesn't take pictures with their phone now? So one thing that I haven't talked about that is important in helping you focus and think about, you know, what are you trying to do? What are the problems that you're trying to solve with integration? Is this piece around partnerships and really being tuned into what are the problems that you're trying to solve in the community? And I had asked Mary Beth this earlier, you know, what are the problems that you're trying to solve? I mean, that becomes like a key reason for thinking about, you know, how you're going to shape and grow your efforts around integration. Because in this presentation, I've only been talking about integrated behavioral health and primary care. We haven't talked about social services. We haven't talked about integration with the criminal justice system, with schools, with hospitals. Those are all possibilities, you know, social services. And the reality is that integrated care, to be, you know, person-centered and to be responsive and to address, you know, the full needs of individuals, there is a need to think beyond just that, the clinic walls, or what happens in the context of the clinic, or just, you know, across these two agencies. It's really important to think more broadly about how you can do cross-sector team-based care and have that level of coordination, how you can have more coordinated and collaborative care across these sectors. And then finally, you know, it's that whole piece around thinking about the screening and the evidence-based clinical practices that are, you know, that could actually benefit and be extended beyond the walls of a clinic. You know, how do you take this into a school? Or how do you, you know, coordinate more intentionally with hospitals as you're having care transitions? How can that be more collaborative and, you know, help with the issue of readmissions? I've mentioned a couple of times the need to think about workforce here, and that's actually a really serious issue. You know, we've identified these new models, they've been tested, but they're really what we know, and what the policies that are driving the uptake of these models is really outpacing where we are with our workforce. And so there is a lot of work that needs to happen, and I mentioned this earlier. Most people get their training on the job. We also have a scenario where, you know, there are mental health provider shortages, and that's not just, I mean, I'm sure that you have, you see lots of nodding, it's national. There are also, you know, the issue that I was mentioning before, the distinct training in behavioral health versus medicine, and the professional cultures and the treatment approaches that come from that. And then the last piece is this issue where behavioral health providers are a little behind medical providers in their capacity to track treatment. And, you know, the impact model is an example of how that can be changed. But we just have to acknowledge that these are challenges, and they're certainly not insurmountable, but This is where we have to think more creatively, you know, are there ways to use promotoras, peer providers, you know, different folks from different walks of life to fulfill the functions that we were talking about earlier. A couple of more challenges, because I just think it's important to know what the challenges are and also recognize that, you know, they can be overcome. One is the progress, you know, it's the progress in the practice transformation and the systems transformation that has been going on, but there are a lot of issues with sustainability and spread. You know, when you are doing programs that are supported through grants and aren't necessarily reimbursable, you know, through a funding stream like Medicaid, it can be challenging. And so it's always important to kind of keep in mind the need to do the grant work, because that allows for the innovation, but then how are you going to pay for it when the grant ends? And we're in a scenario right now where, we are going to have many changes, as we know, you know, with the new administration, with the ACA and that kind of thing. Nobody really knows exactly what's going to happen. But, you know, what I do believe is important to hold on to is the fact that it's going to be pretty hard to go back from now. We've created this body of evidence, and a lot of people have gotten trained in these new ways of doing work that make so much sense. So I think that, we have started to make the culture shift, and now we just have to make sure that we have the reimbursement environment that can support that. And that's why it's so important to be able to demonstrate your outcomes and think about things like return on investment, and think beyond return on investment within your four clinic walls. Think about it in terms of, you know, if you didn't have your program, how many more people would be going to jail because of substance use issues? Or how many more people would be inappropriately using the emergency department? So starting to, we have to get creative about the way that we're being, that we demonstrate value of our programs. I do want to acknowledge this piece, which is the shifting from data collection for compliance to using data for accountability. That's another issue for behavioral health providers. Most state programs, they want you to count widgets. They're not really looking for improvement or outcomes. It's how many units of service did you deliver? And the same has been true on the medical side, but that's been changing more quickly. But I think that's still very much a value that has now, you know, it's out there. I think that we've all been starting to do it. And that's going to be, I hope, assuming that the ACA goes away, I'm hopeful that whatever it is replacing it, we'll continue to have that as an important value. Now I have this, again, another busy slide, but I wanted to just give you a framework to think about the fact that there are many assessment tools. I mean, if you ever are wondering, wow, how integrated are we, you know, as a clinic or as a program, there are assessment tools that you can use to figure out, you know, how do you know it when you see it? How do you know integration when you see it? And none of them are perfect. The way the detail that's in this, and I can provide a better version of this for you. The detail in this, I broke it up by the primary application, you know, when do you use it? What's it trying to do? So, some of it is around readiness for integration. Some of it is for understanding your levels of integration assessment and capacity assessments, that sort of thing. The next row is on structure, and there I give you the count of how many items are in the instrument. So some of them are very detailed, like it has 65 items and over 100 items compared to, you know, this one that has 8 questions. Sometimes less is more and sometimes it's not. I mean, it really depends on what's the question, what are you trying to answer with it. This third piece is the implementation approach, and I've detailed, you know, how do you implement it. Many of them actually use the strategy of bringing different folks together in an organization to look at it, recognizing that, you know, it's like the blind man and the elephant. You know, you can't get the whole without getting, you know, everybody's perspective. There are some that are, you know, more of an organizational self-assessment where one person could fill it out. But if you ever do anything like this, I really encourage you to bring in more people. And then the final piece is just giving you a sense of the measure type. So some of them are Likert and yes, no questions. Some are using scales or decision trees. But I just wanted to make sure that you knew that there are ways to kind of score your program. And I don't mean that in a, you know, it's better or worse, but to just kind of know where you are so that it helps with your strategy of moving forward. And recognizing that, you know, I mean, on the individual level, the patient level, we're talking about measurement and outcomes and that kind of thing. But there are ways to kind of think about measurement and outcomes of the overall program by thinking about what are the characteristics that we have and how integrated are we really. So this slide is really about lessons learned. And you know, it's leveraging the tools for improvement and sustainability. None of those models that I just showed you, none of those tools are perfect. And none of them have really been validated over time, but I still think that they're very useful, especially as, you know, kind of getting a sense and having a bridgehead for conversations. The other piece is that it's important to define and document your model. Like I was saying before, I mean, you want to know, is the model, have we hit a stable place with our model? Or if this social worker leaves, does our model go to hell in the handbasket? You know, things like that. I mean, that becomes another reason to do that. And then it also gives you a way to talk about your model in a more structured kind of way. And then it's also important to define your goals. Like I had said before, you know, when you're choosing a tool, you really do have to step back and say, well, what are we trying to accomplish with this integration piece? I mean, I know that you all have a focus on diabetes and depression, and then, you know, my assumption is that there are many other behavioral health needs that have cropped up. And so you're not just seeing folks with diabetes and depression. So it's getting very clear on what are we trying to accomplish more broadly with integrated behavioral health. So this is just a reminder to us all that the work that you do is essential, and all of this is new, and nobody really has the answers. I mean, I've been studying integration since the mid-1990s, but it keeps evolving, and we keep learning more and more about it. At that time, it was very much thought that it was really, you know, the clinical team that needed to be integrated, as opposed to thinking about integration from the standpoint of organizational structures. And, you know, what has been learned over time is much more about capacity and much more about these, you know, the importance of relationships and leadership and all of those kinds of things. But we're still learning. And that again becomes part of your story and why it's so important to document it and be able to, you know, to create that narrative about what you're doing and how things have improved or why things are different at this point.
I heard you touch briefly on the importance of having shared electronic health records for integrated care. I've seen programs try to use patient registry or disease registry for a similar purpose. Could you say something about whether that registry should be an add-on or whether it actually can be used as a substitute for getting those records integrated? I know especially where there's more than one agency collaborating, it can be especially challenging to do that.
Yeah, that's a great question. Do you want to hold your second question and answer that? Okay. That's a really great question, because I was a little cavalier by saying, oh, you know, because that really is the ideal. But we also have to be very clear that organizations and systems have invested lots and lots and lots of money into legacy software systems. And typically what you want to do is, to the extent that you can, extend them and use your duct tape or, you know, whatever it is that's holding them together. And the concept of interoperability across these systems is very challenging. There are tools that, like registries that I've seen, that are able to kind of help things meet in the middle. There are also cloud-based solutions where, you know, especially for care management, I mean, Your point about the registries, can the registries be used? I would say yes and no. It depends on the function of, the functionality of them, what's contained in them, how easy is it to get the information out, and to what extent can it really be used to support care coordination, care management. Typically in our, electronic health records, we don't have something for care management. You might have notes or something like that, but it's not information that you can really get out. I think that this is very evolving. I mean, I don't have a great answer for you on this. I think that, it goes back to being very clear, what are you trying to do with this? My bias is that I think where we want to go with this is to make sure that the data that we're collecting, the information that we're collecting, actually is useful to the patient and is useful to all of the clinicians, all of the providers, so that they can, make decisions. And then it's also really important from that broader standpoint, from that population health standpoint, to be able to then look at the data in the aggregate. And that is one of the big limitations with so many of our systems, where you can look patient by patient by patient, but if I said, 100% of your population, what percentage have diabetes, depression, who's getting better? That becomes the function of the registry, but that also can, it can become a challenge for workflow. So that's a long way of saying it's very complicated. There are solutions. It's important to be very clear about what you're trying to do with it.
So my second question. I know that with IVH programs, we often focus on the PHQ-9 and depression. And I'm just thinking about how anxiety is so intertwined with depression and often a comorbidity. And I wonder, are there IVH programs out there that are also tracking the GAD-7
yes.
or something?
Yes.
And how common is that?
That's I do a lot of work in California, and that is, at this point, pretty common across the qualified health centers to do both the GAD-7 and to do the PHQ-9. The tricky thing with the GAD-7, or really, I mean, anything beyond the PHQ-9, there hasn't been great research to show improvement. Whether these measures are really sensitive enough to show improvement, and I know providers who swear by the GAD-7 and say it's fine. It's just that it hasn't been really tested in the literature, which is why you're not seeing those indicators show up in some of the national standards and even state standards for outcomes. I would just invite you all to, not be afraid. I mean, just because it's not on the NCQA list, if there is a measure that you think can be helpful for managing your population, go ahead and use it.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any questions?
Thank you. I was just wondering, can you give us an example of who has it right? Who's doing this well here in San Antonio? And then more on a macro level, have you seen more success institutionally, like with the county or organization or with private insurance?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, the caveat here is that I'm not from Texas and I don't know your system, but what I heard from Mary Beth this morning about the work that is being done here, it sounds like you have a lot of the right components. And in fact, my hunch is that you're doing it quite well. I think that some of the challenges are really making the business case of it and taking it to scale so that more people can be served. I mean, if you have, Mary Beth, you were mentioning you have two behavioral providers.
Yes.
Embedded. I mean, that's not a lot for a clinic that's seeing the number of lives that are being seen. If we think about, people, that statistic that I gave you earlier around, 29% of the population that has chronic conditions has a comorbid behavioral health issue, that becomes a challenge. In terms of the county piece, are you talking about like the specialty behavioral health system?
Right. I'm thinking,
people with.
Here we have like the Center for Healthcare Service is a mental health provider, but I'm wondering, there's probably costs we know there's costs of doing a model like this. It's challenging. So I was wondering is, have you seen more success in institutional setting or with private insurance? Have they been able to do this easier than those institutional settings?
And I don't have a very, like a super clear answer for you on that because I would say it depends a little bit, but part of it is being clear about what are the reimbursement opportunities. You know, it's, I mean, if the goal is to move from grants, you have to think about what is reimbursable and under what conditions with Medicaid or Medicare, and even private insurance. I mean, understanding like what private insurance will cover and then what behavioral health requirements are going to match onto what covers and what are the reporting expectations and that kind of thing. So that definitely comes into play. I think in the context of you know, more of the institutional, like if we're thinking about county behavioral health services and that kind of thing, there are successes, but that's also, you know, and this is where I get a little harsh because I look at it in terms of people are dying 25 years earlier in that population. And that's not okay, and that's been happening for a while. I mean, it's been happening on the watch of our behavioral health county and state people. And I hold a lot of responsibility, you know, in that space because, yes, it's been fantastic that we've had all these advances in psychotropic drugs and, you know, the atypical antipsychotics and that kind of thing. The side effect profiles of those medications, terrible. And nobody really paid any attention. And I've had too many conversations where, you know, where counties realize, oh my gosh, you know, we thought that this patient was doing great and then she dropped dead at the age of 40 because they were attending their, you know, their counseling sessions or, you know, that sort of thing, but nobody was paying attention to the fact that the person had high blood pressure and diabetes and that kind of thing. So I know I didn't quite answer your question because I don't have a very quick answer, but.
Can we have a comment to that particular question right here?
Our clinic is on Fredericksburg Road and we serve adults who are severely mentally ill, and about 2 years ago we integrated primary care. Yeah, and we've had great success. Our primary care services are, of course, paid for by insurance if the clients have insurance, but also heavily supplemented by grants. And so that's how we've had to get funding through that. But we've had amazing successes. The way we get clients is oftentimes referrals for high emergency care services. And we've even seen their BMI indexes go down, and we've seen really great successes. And I don't know, it's been really good in the county, but it is few and far between, and we are trying to access the most severely mentally ill population here.
That's fantastic. I mean, and that's the step in the right direction. And that, you know, across the country, we're seeing more integration, bi-directional integration in that way. And it's very much in response because it does work, and it's very much in response to this crisis that we've had. And, you know, SAMHSA has been with the certified community, CCBHC is certified community behavioral health centers, I think. They're, you know, in fact, I think today they're announcing which states are going to be in the pilot for these. And this is really moving, it's a movement toward making county behavioral health clinics more like FQHCs, which is really exciting. It's a new funding stream.
Yes. We have another question.
You have not mentioned the cost of electronic health records, integrating these with paper health records. I just read in the morning paper how the major cancer centers in Houston are having a very difficult time with this. It not only was extremely expensive, but the physicians were taking a lot of their patient time just to learn the system. So could you address that, please?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely an issue. I mean, there is a cost to transitioning the way that we keep records into the 21st century. I mean, there's no question about that. And there have been federal funds that have financed a lot of that transition, you know, but certainly not across, I mean, there are still, the example that you just gave, I mean, there's still many systems that are still using paper. And it's, you know, it's a best practice. It has been, you know, demonstrated that the ideal scenario would be that you would have an electronic record, and it certainly does facilitate information sharing and that kind of thing, and the need to not have a physical fax or, you know, the filing in the medical records department, that kind of thing. But, you know, your point is really very well taken, because it definitely is, you know, it's not insurmountable, because there's the cost of purchasing the system, and then there's also the level of effort that it takes on. Yeah, absolutely. But there are, you know, I mean, people have been doing it, and, you know, there are, it is definitely a big hurdle, but once the system has moved over, you know, into the electronic space, most people would say that the benefits outweigh the costs.
One oncologist shared with me that it was costing you $40,000 a year just to keep the system going.
Yeah.
That's a lot of money.
That is a lot of money.
We have another question here.
And well, actually, it was a comment based off of Jennifer's. I work with Superior Health Plan, the Medicaid provider, and I work on the behavioral health side. And about 2 years ago, we started integration within the insurance company. And so I think, like she was saying, there's such a positive outcome from that. You know, we've noticed based off of our reports, the decrease of hospitalizations, the ER, you know, and what we found a lot of times, it's just like you had shared earlier, the lack of resources, the lack of behavioral health providers, you know, a lot of paperwork and not enough time, you know. San Antonio has a high homeless population, and so we were able to work with one of the physicians there that worked, you know, for physical health, and we were able to help, you know, coordinate behavioral and physical, because a lot of these members were going into the hospital. But the integration, I think, here in San Antonio is definitely happening, and so yeah, it's positive. It's such an amazing, it's amazing how you can see how diabetes or liver issues can exacerbate psychosis and behavioral health issues, and being able to determine, hey, this is what can possibly be the root cause, is really helpful to help the members become more successful.
That's great.
Another question, and then we'll go to our final question over here in the room. And this relates to the measurement of the cost associated with, or the benefit, cost savings from the ER visits, from the incarceration, and so forth. Within a population, and this young lady just talked about some of those ways in which you can correlate and track that, but on a larger scale with, for example, say incarceration, in a community who has, you know, many providers, trying to get our hands around, how can we best measure that? Do you have an example you could share with us?
Sure. I mean, I think that the place to look for evidence and for outcomes to measure and that kind of thing would be the substance use literature. I mean, there have been many studies that have been, you know, done that are looking at the connection between substance use and incarceration, and that revolving door that happens and that sort of thing. And so the measurement, you know, comes down to being able to make those linkages. I mean, part of this is another scenario where it's hard to track. You actually have to do a lot of upfront work to say, okay, you know, who's your population? This is my population. Where do we have any kind of overlap? Looking at history of criminal record, that kind of thing. But, you know, so there are indicators that you can track, but there are steps that need to be taken to make that possible. It's the same kind of thing with frequent users of emergency departments, and it sounds like you all have that internal capacity, which is great when you have a health plan, because you have the data on, you know, who's using all the different systems. And that's why the partnership piece becomes so important. I mean, 10 years ago, I would never have, the health plan piece of it never even occurred to me. And then all of a sudden, and so I was working with lots of programs where you had a hospital and you had a community-based provider and a clinic, and, you know, we were jiggering all these things to get people to share data so that I could, you know, do the evaluation and look at the cost piece. And, it was a lot of work. And yes, you know, we could demonstrate things, but when you have the insurance company that really creates a big opportunity. When you're talking about something like the criminal justice system, though, you're talking about a completely different system. So, yeah. So that was a long way of not really giving you a great answer, except to say you can do it, and you have to be intentional about it, and it requires, a desire to look for this. And then, creating the relationship so that you can have that shared conversation and understanding what are the problems on the side of the criminal justice system that can be prevented by, the integration on, for substance use services or mental health services.
Perfect. And we have one final question.
I just wanted to mention that Methodist Healthcare Ministries is hosting integrated primary care behavioral health peer networking group Wednesday, January 4th from 4:30 to 6 at our corporate offices, 4507 Medical Drive in our boardroom. And everyone that has an interest is invited. It's open to doctors, practitioners, administrators, whoever has an interest.
It's a wonderful forum. Thank you so much. And thank you, Dr. Linkins.
Sure. Please let's thank her.
Dr. Linkins, she'll be here for a few minutes to help folks have additional questions or would like to share. Thank you all for coming, and again, thank you to our sponsor, Methodist Healthcare Ministries, for allowing us to have the program we have today.